our service today is in the spirit of earth-centered traditions. We're in the midst of a sermon series exploring the six sources of our Unitarian Universalist faith, the sources that ground our living tradition. So far, we've talked about the direct experience of transcending mystery and wonder, the words and deeds of prophetic women and men, Jewish and Christian teachings, and humanist teachings. And even though we sometimes experience tensions over the multiplicity of sources that inform our Unitarian Universalist faith, we are proud of that diversity. And we're also proud of the fact that our religion is a living tradition. In some ways, we're more akin to the ancient oral traditions with their flexibility and their adaptability. The traditional Western traditions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, religions of the book, all have the sources of written authority that are at least metaphorically carved in stone. Long ago, our Unitarian Universalist forebears made a decision to move beyond this carved-in-stone tradition. Times changed and our worldview expanded. Progress happens. Revelation is not sealed. Why close Revelation when it so clearly continues to unfold before our very eyes? We view our principles and even the language used in expressing what we understand to be these six sources of our faith as a piece of oral tradition to be passed on, listened to, retold, and changed again as circumstances changed. We actually recently went through a multi-year process of looking at our principles, the seven principles, and we went all the way back to every single congregation where they chewed on them, and then they gave their recommendations, and it went up to the group that was looking at it. And after, I think it was like a three-year process, wouldn't you know, we decided we liked our principles just as they were. But it's a good conversation to have. It's a good and necessary conversation to have. Because our sources, the six sources of our faith, were actually expanded several decades ago. You might remember that in the very beginning, when the Unitarians and Universalists decided to join together in 1961, when they decided to set forth their sources, there were only five sources. And I'm not sure what the age of the hymnals are here, but if you look in our gray hymnals, some of the hymnals, if they were before 1995, have only five sources listed. Because that, so those were adopted at the 1984 and 1985 General Assemblies. And then, a decade later, in 1995, in the spirit of acknowledging what many Unitarian Universalists felt as a core source, as yet unstated, our sixth source was adopted. So today we turn our minds and hearts and our bodies to our sixth source, the spiritual teachings of earth-centered traditions that celebrate the sacred circle of life and instruct us to live in harmony with the rhythms of nature. And as we all know, earth-based spirituality itself is not new. In fact, it is the most ancient of practices. In our Unitarian Universalist context, we draw together many threads. The ancient pagan religions of Middle East and Europe, indigenous cultures around the globe, and our own native spirituality. Understanding our sixth source also pulls together contemporary threads of feminist theology, and the spiritual perspectives of the environmental and sustainability movements. Let's begin with a quick look at some of the key theological underpinnings of our source. Paganism. This is a loaded word in our culture, right? Did some of you kind of go, ooh. sort of cultural baggage that I invite each and every one of us to get rid of. It's remnants of attempts by Christianity and Judaism to eliminate the so-called primitive religions from the cultures that they wished to dominate. The word is derived from a Latin root, which simply means a country dweller. In early centuries of the Common Era, Christianity was centered mostly where there were people together, so in towns and cities. And so in the far-flung rural portions of the Roman Empire, the people who worked the earth and continued to practice their earth religion centered their lives on the cycles of the season. And similarly, the word heathen referred to people who lived on the heaths in England. Again, rural farmers tied to the soil and to agricultural cycles. The old pagan religions recognized this cyclical nature of life because they lived by those cycles. Given the importance to their livelihoods of fertility, divinity was often imagined in the image of the feminine. And as Christianity ascended, it made certain strategic choices to appropriate elements and dates from the pagan calendar to lessen the power of that ancient faith. But that's another sermon for another time. I promise you that one will be coming. Today we have neo-pagans with rituals planned around the cycles of the season. Perhaps the most familiar to us being the solstice celebrations. Neo-paganism draws from the old pagan religion, which never really disappeared because it is so core to our being as human beings. And it also draws from the increasing awareness of the impact of technology on all of life and is focused on this human relationship to the earth. Our seventh principle, respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part, also speaks to this awareness. In neo-paganism and Unitarian Universalism, we voice our need for environmental stewardship, ending the exploitation of our Mother Earth and the cosmos, and understanding ourselves not as isolated individuals, but rather part of this interdependent web of life. The natural world is understood as our home and not something to be tamed or conquered. And if you think that's a matter of course, think again. Our history has been, it's something to be tamed and conquered. So I feel that we're really shifting the consciousness that's happening right now, and we're at the forefront of it. It's a very exciting time to be a Unitarian Universalist. Humans are not the owners or exploitative manipulators of the environment, but are intimately and intricately connected to the earth, all of us part of the greater whole. A key understanding in neo-paganism is the divinity in all things, in trees, and mountains, and animals, and people, and rocks. In theological jargon, we call this pantheism, an immanent, here, dynamic spirit present in all things. The inherent worth that we're born with, our first Unitarian Universalist principle, extended to everything in creation. Another thread that celebrates the sacred circle of life and instructs us to live in harmony with the rhythms of nature is the, in the longer scheme of things, fairly recent women's movement, including the reclaiming of the feminine divine in feminist theology. You might remember books such as Rhiannon Eisler's The Chalice and the Blade. Seems like people who read that. That spoke of our prehistory, where cultures in the more fertile regions of our globe oriented primarily to the egalitarian partnership model between the sexes. The gender partnership was a core component of some of these more peaceful matriarchal cultures with a focus on being life-giving, centering on nature. Prior to the suppression of paganism, you had multiple feminine manifestations of the divine, and then came the suppression of the goddess. The human understanding of the holy suffered, and it became narrower, as essential characteristics that were associated with the feminine were either discredited or discarded. Earth-based religion, our sixth source, allows us to once again celebrate those characteristics. Creativity, cycles tied to the earth and our bodies, procreativity, nurturing, healing. Another thread of contemporary earth-based spirituality emerges out of our Native American cultures. There is a great diversity of indigenous cultures here in our now United States, but there is one common understanding to most of the groups, and it is this image of our Mother Earth. This is why I put the service on this day, because it just seemed to fit so beautifully for Mother's Day. Scholars tell us that tribal identity for eons was tied to the land that a particular group lived on. And when the tribes were pushed off their land by the encroaching Europeans, identity crises ensued. So the Mother Earth concept, according to some scholars, was an idea that evolved out of a need to reclaim this relationship with the sacred land that they were no longer allowed to live on. And this concept of our Mother Earth is also one that resonates strongly with many Unitarian Universalists as we understand ourselves as part of this interdependent web. Do some of these threads and ideas resonate with you in your Unitarian Universalist identity? They should, because although it took a while for us as a whole to articulate it clearly, this concept is not a new one to Unitarian and Universalist thought. Our adoption, I can't believe it took us so long, our adoption of our sixth source in 1995 is more of a homecoming rather than something new to our faith. Our Unitarian forebears, the transcendentalist poets and authors of the 19th century, proclaimed that divinity or spirit was in all of nature. And Unitarians acknowledge the importance of naturalism in religion. William Ellery Channing, the minister who proudly claimed our Unitarian name, spoke in the early 1800s about human beings' ability to develop the divinity within her or himself, creating a link to a broader based acceptance of spirit as a dynamic essence. Margaret Fuller, raised in a social environment heavily influenced by Channing, she was a dynamic member of the transcendentalist movement as she developed the social implications of these philosophies, particularly in the full equality of women and men. She was a groundbreaker, Margaret Fuller. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Unitarian minister, wrote, "Spirit does not act upon us from without, but through us," and spoke of nature as a spiritual teacher. If you gather a roomful of Unitarian Universalists together, in my experience, a majority would say that nature is a primary spiritual connection in their lives. So let's try it. How many of you feel that the ideas that I've just shared as being important to Earth-centered traditions, the importance and love of the natural world, our human role as part of the interdependent web, not the apex, Mother Earth, a common reverence, some might call it spirit, some not, in all, cycles of the natural world and the seasons, environmental stewardship, are these things important to you, perhaps even central in your spiritual life? Another point of convergence with earth-based spirituality that shares with Unitarian Universalism is a trust in our personal experience over external authority. Remember our first source. Our living tradition draws from the direct experience of that transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces that create and uphold life. Joseph Campbell, in The Power of Myth, says, "People say that what we're all seeking is a meaning for life. I don't think that's what we're really seeking. I think that what we're seeking is an experience of being alive, so that our life experiences on a purely physical plane will have resonance within our innermost being of reality, so that we actually feel the rapture, the joy of being alive." And practitioners of modern earth-based practices seek to craft rituals that create this unmediated experience of being alive, of being connected to others, and connected to the earth herself. To practice those rituals is to feel deep gratitude for connections. This is part of why we're including these embodied elements in our service today. Many of our, if you want to call them, regular services, include some of these elements already. But today we're really focusing more on them. I want to say a word here about a Unitarian Universalist group that celebrates the traditions that are lifted up in our sixth source. It's called CUPS. Have you heard of that group before? Okay. The Covenant of Unitarian Universalist Pagans. So CUPS groups invite Unitarian Universalists into their circle as they mark the natural cycles of the year, the solstice, the equinox, harvest, planting, birth, death. The wonderful group that helped create today's service and identify with this earth-centered spirituality are interested in finding out who else might be interested in our congregation of forming either a CUPS group or maybe a broader earth-based group here at Live Oak. And so if you'd like to put your name on a list, we welcome you after the service is over to go to, who has the list? The list will be somewhere over here with Christina. So if you're interested, it looks like we're going to get a group started here at Live Oak. So you're welcome to be a founding member. These are earth-centered traditions which celebrate the sacred circle of life and instruct us to live in harmony with the rhythms of nature. We mark the sacred circle of life and rhythms of nature in multiple ways. We celebrate the seasons and the turning of the year in the threads already stated and also with various rituals and remembrances. It means that something as simple, maybe not so simple, as celebrating a birthday, we think about the sacredness of each life and what life means to us and to others. It means that when we come together to mourn the loss of a life, we think of the sacredness of that life and how that life has changed us and how we've been affected. It means that when we get married or our friends and loved ones married, that this relationship, this bond between two people, strengthens and increases the love in the world, thereby strengthening and increasing the love that we experience in the world. We human beings are people of patterns and rhythms and cycles, and our connection to the earth and those patterns and rhythms and cycles, that's basic to our growth and our very survival. Former Unitarian Universalist Association President Bill Schultz said, "What could be more crucial for the present day than the nurturance of an organic faith that refuses to truck with nationalism or cultural stereotyping, but is faithful first to the needs of our planet? Human survival depends on our willingness to think and act in global and non-dualistic ways. violence is almost always a function of diminished imagination. With respect for the earth and our tradition of universal sympathy, Unitarian Universalism might well model a new way of being in the world. Let us work together to make it so as we celebrate the sacred circle of life and live in harmony with the rhythms of nature. Blessed be, and I invite you to a short time